We're reaching that point now in the semester and in the history of Imperial Russia, where Russia is once again trying to catch up with and take advantage of the technological developments that are emerging out of Western Europe and increasingly the United States. And what's curious is that the three decades that precede the outbreak of the First World War in 1914 are really marked by some of the most unprecedented technological and scientific developments in all of Russian history. The state policies that are established in the wake of the great reforms that were intended to jumpstart industrialization, the increasing openness of domestic markets to foreign investors, the influx of modern methods, devices, and services are all going to contribute to a period in Russian history in which we see more profound change than at any time since arguably the reign of Peter the Great. So the developments are going to begin coming very, very rapidly. And it mirrors in many respects earlier developments, say in Europe and in the United States. The development is uneven and it's frenetic. We talked about the Industrial Revolution unfolding on the European continent, and I mentioned it doesn't unfold evenly. There are pockets of progress that emerge hither and there. And the same thing is going to be true in the Russian case. So the growth is frenetic, it's uneven, it is more quantitative, sometimes not exactly qualitative, but in other instances, there are improvements as well in the efficiencies and the manner in which the production is undertaken. Just to give you an idea here, generally speaking, the period between 1885 and 1914 witnesses an annualized growth rate, of 3.25%. 3.25% growth each and every year on an annual basis during that 30-year period. This means Russia is growing. The Russian economy is growing among the fastest rates in all of Europe. And that, of course, means at this time, almost in the world. Not quite keeping up with American growth, but nevertheless, it's very, very impressive. As the Tsarist Empire begins embarking on its industrial takeoff, finally, it faces a dilemma, and it's a dilemma that we've encountered in this class time and time again. The leading states of Europe, France, Britain, Germany, and the United States, their growth rates haven't stopped. They, too, are also growing, and they're growing to an even greater degree in terms of the technological innovation that's being introduced. This period in European history is oftentimes referred to as the Second Industrial Revolution. Second Industrial Revolution. It marks the two generations between the late 1860s, early 1870s, and the onset of World War I. And this period in history sees a staggering array of technological and scientific advances emerging out of Europe and emerging out of the United States. They involve steel, electricity, the development of the internal combustion engine. These are the most noteworthy. But there are also the advent of the modern petroleum industry, the development of the chemical industry. New products and processes are going to be coming online, and they're going to begin reaching consumers at a very rapid rate. In fact, the number of epoch-defining devices that are invented between 1870 and 1914 is simply astounding. There is virtually no aspect of human activity, from transportation and construction to manufacturing, entertainment and the arts, war-making, domestic life, that is not affected by some degree of technological or scientific change. If we step back and we look at this period from the big picture, we look at the nature of inventions that we've seen so far this semester, steamboats and railways, telegraphs, new modes of transportation, new modes of communication. This particular period witnesses a concentration of innovation and development that really is unprecedented in human history. By the end of the 1870s, telephones, sound recordings, light bulbs, typewriters, and reinforced concrete emerge for the first time for individuals to experience and to utilize. During the 1880s, we witnessed the first practical electrical motors, electric lights, steam turbines, inflatable rubber tires, skyscrapers, and the industrial manufacture of aluminum. Diesel engines, motion pictures, and x-rays are going to appear in the 1890s. Mass-produced automobiles, airplanes, tractors, neon lights, air conditioning, and vacuum diodes and triodes emerge in the 15 years that precede the First World War. Taken individually, any one of these inventions is an absolutely transformative device. But what's curious about this particular period in human history, it's not just the big things. sort of mundane everyday items are also going to be invented, ones that we don't even think about today, but that are ubiquitous in human life. Flat-bottomed paper bags, 1867. Spring tape measures, 1868. Shower sprinkler heads, paper clips, bottle caps, safety razors, zippers, all of these things are going to emerge during this particular period in European development. It's not simply the astounding scope and variety of inventions that mark this period as being unique. The other thing that's true about this is we have a period in which these devices are invented, but then very rapidly become ordinary everyday items that consumers can utilize or can purchase. You think, for example, about Fulton's steamboat, invented by the Clermont, invented in 1807. It takes, you know, until the 1840s, the 1850s, for the steamboat to gradually penetrate and what I would say diffuse as a transportation technology, even in the United States of America. In the case of Russia, we talked about the difficulties of trying to not only develop steamboat construction, but its diffusion in Russia means that by the 1850s, the 1860s, there are no more than a couple of dozen steamboats in the entire country. It takes much, much longer, earlier, for these technologies to diffuse. Why? Because of the new infrastructures that have emerged with communication, commercialization, research, and development. This period has been defined by one historian, a fellow by the name of Václav Smil, as the Age of Synergy. And that's the phrase that I much prefer to use in the Second Industrial Revolution, because it speaks here as well to the qualitative difference, and then, say, the First Industrial Revolution, and the extent to which you have a whole host of factors that are coming together to help ensure that technological innovation is going to increase at an increasingly rapid rate. What are those factors? High technical literacy, widespread scientific understanding, rapid feedback between research and commercialization. All of these are going to account in Europe and the West for a quickening pace of innovation. The rise of the modern knowledge economy that we talked about the last time, comprising readily available scientific and technical publications, geared towards general readers, a network of research-oriented universities, independent scientific organizations and societies, professional associations. All of these are going to greatly accelerate the production of theoretical knowledge and the transformation of theoretical knowledge into practical applications and usable things. Russians' initial encounters with this era's rapidly multiplying devices and systems takes place relatively quickly. And if we think back now to the other technological devices that we have seen enter into Russia, we know that Russian experience is delayed, but it's not delayed by that much. Fulton's steamboat, to use that same example, is developed in 1807. It's under the reign of Alexander I in 1812, 1813 that the first steamboat, there's a first attempt by the Tsar state to bring the steamboat to Russia. That's only about 5 or 6 years after the steamboat's development. Same thing is true with the railroad. We talked about that first rail line, the Manchester-Liverpool rail line in Britain. It's developed in the early 1830s. By 1834, the Russians are working with Gerstner on the development of the St. Petersburg-Tsarskoye-Selo railway. So that's the funny thing about Russian technological development. The state and its agents are acting throughout Russian history relatively quickly. They recognize the technology. They recognize its importance for the state's development, for its modernization, for its industry, for its economy, for its military. And they want to bring that technology as quickly as they can into Russia itself. That's not the problem. The problem is developing then the domestic infrastructure, not only the factories and the energy that you need to produce these machines, but developing as well that knowledge economy, that group of experts and technicians and scientists who can actually build or at least manage and administer these incredibly complex systems. And recall, that was one of the problems with Gerstner's railroad. Gerstner has to go abroad to bring the expertise and the technology in, and once there, it functions, but only with the help, again, of foreign administrators and foreign managers. So this is one of the things that Russia is going to have to solve. The Russian government, Russian state leaders, and increasingly now Russian private citizens, in their voluntary and professional association, they're recognizing these technologies, they want to bring them to Russia. You're trying very much, very quickly to build that knowledge economy. polytechnic institutes and universities, and I'll talk more about that today as well, that's going to be absolutely critical to ensuring that you have the usable knowledge present in the minds and hearts of men and women around the empire. And the same thing is going to be true here in this age of synergy. The new technologies that emerge, they actually arrive for the first time in Russia very quickly after their development in Europe. So you end up, for example, with the telephones. First telephones arrived in Russia in 1882. The first electric trams. There we go. There's St. Petersburg in 1910. And if you take a look at this photograph and you ignore the statue that no longer exists, it's torn down during the Russian Revolution, that could be Vienna. That could be Berlin. That could be any European city. It doesn't look that much appreciably different because it isn't. Where you're going to see the real differences is when you step outside of St. Petersburg and Moscow, the major urban settlements, and you go into the countryside. There's still going to be issues there between the city and the urban environments. But let's take, for example, the first electric tram. It arrives in Russia, in Kiev of all places in 1892. The first automobile, 1896. Motion pictures, 1896. The first showing of a motion picture in Russia in 1896 takes place within a year of the motion picture's appearance in France. So the technology's initial arrival in Russia is quick. The problem is the subsequent spread or the diffusion of these technological systems beyond major metropolitan areas like Moscow and St. Petersburg. That is going to occur in the Russian context only slowly and haphazardly. Why? Same factors we've encountered already this semester. Huge territorial expanses, inadequate manufacturing capacity, immature capital markets, relative poverty, and low literacy rates. These are going to forestall the diffusion of these technological systems throughout the empire. These same factors are also going to hinder native Russian innovation. This is a period of immense scientific, technical, and creative energy. Where do we look within Russia to see these kinds of energies being developed? The foundation of all of this had been laid in the aftermath of the emancipation, with that process and a series of great reforms that are introduced by Alexander II. And I talked the last time that we met about the foundations of the knowledge economy and the extent to which the development of this knowledge economy through the process, the policy of glasnost, greater openness to information, but also the expanse of education with the university statute, for example, is specifically designed to bring more and more amounts of information into Russia that is usable to the state, usable as well to scientific and technological figures, if that makes sense. You're trying to build a knowledge base so that you can innovate, so that you can master these increasingly important new technological systems. One of the principal elements of this, of course, is going to be the Russian Technical Society. The Russian Technical Society. Voluntary associations like this one were absolutely essential to developing Russia's knowledge economy in the 1870s and the 1880s. But the fact of the matter is, no matter how much the state is going to allow societies of these types to function, they still could not compensate, their presence could not compensate for the absence of a tradition of strong property rights, rule of law, local powers and privileges, and those intermediary political and social bodies that exist in the West, that give technicians and scientists and private citizens an area in which they can operate free from state interference and state influence. The state, as a result, is going to continue to dominate domestic research and development in Russia, as it had for decades, if not centuries. As in the past, government agents are going to favor projects tied to military and industrial modernization. But even the highest priority programs, programs the state recognizes need to be developed, can fall victim to funding shortages and bureaucratic inertia. One of the examples that I gave the last time that I talked about this was a fellow by the name of Dmitry Mendeleev. Dmitry Mendeleev, the chemist. He's the fellow who in the 1870s had gotten funding to build a research laboratory through the Russian Technical Society. They're able to leverage their political patronage ties. They secure funding from Mendeleev, Mendeleev pitches his project as something that's going to help the military, even though it's basic research. He labors for a decade. He's under pressure to produce practical results. He's not really interested in that. He's discovering basic and fundamental principles. Later, of course, Mendeleev is going to create the periodic table of the elements. It's kind of an important thing in the history of science. But he finally is going to throw up his hands and he's going to resign his position because he's so frustrated at the government interference. That's an example of the way in which the state, even in attempting to spur research, could prove a retarding force in the development here of native Russian ingenuity and development. Now, none of this is to say that Russia lacked creative talent. Almost any college course that you're going to take, we talk about the First World War, we talk about the Soviet Union the next time around, talk about how Russia is always behind the West. Why is it the Russians can't get anything done? Why aren't they as smart? Why aren't they as capable? Why are they so damn backwards? Fact of the matter is, this period in Russian history, they are immensely creative. You just don't know about it. You haven't heard about these folks. In no small part because time and time again, the most inventive, the most creative, the most brilliant Russians find themselves constrained by the economic, political, cultural context in which they are trying to operate, to innovate, and to develop new technologies. I'm going to mention a few names very briefly, and then what we're going to do a little bit later is we're going to go into a couple of what I'm going to call case studies of Russian technological development. We're going to talk about folks you've probably never heard of, who are absolutely brilliant pioneers, and in some ways preceded developments for which Americans or Europeans are going to garner accolades. So some of these folks really aren't known well today, and I'm not going to ask you, if there's not a date by their name, you're not going to have to remember the name. Don't freak out. I just want you to understand here and grasp the bigger picture. These two fellows, Nikolai Bernardos and Nikolai Slavyanov, they devised the first practical arc welding methods in the mid-1880s. You know what arc welding is? It's kind of important, isn't it? That's a Russian contribution to the development of history of technology and science. A maritime engineer by the name of Alexei Krylov, he undertakes foundational research and writing on the gyrocompass. Dmitry Lachionov is author of Russia's first textbook on meteorology and climatology. This fellow, Boris Golitsyn, he invents the electromagnetic seismograph, 1906, for measuring the movement in of the tectonic plates. All of these are pretty big deals. Arc welding, a seismograph. A fellow by the name of Alexander Loron is credited with the first foam fire extinguisher. Why would you want foam fire extinguishers in Russia? So many of the buildings are still made out of wood. Fires continued to be a problem into the early 20th century. Now, I will say that relative to the size of the Russian Empire, relative to the size of the Russian Empire's population, the number of these inventors is very small. It's very small. But the point is that Russians are contributing in very important ways to this emerging age of synergy. But it is also true that the overall impact of Russian ingenuity is comparatively limited. When we look at this period in Russian history, the 1880s, the 1890s, the turn of the 20th century, what we find is that Russian technical and scientific innovation is typically manifested in standalone devices designed by individuals who lacked access to capital, lacked access to consumer markets, and thus were unable to maintain continuous research programs. This is very different than what's happening in the West. In Europe, and especially the United States at this time, that synergistic activity of inventors, entrepreneurs, and consumers is what sustains serial development and the commercialization of new technological systems. That's the difference. You have a synergy of forces that have come together in the West, industry, university, research, commercialization, patent law, that create context in which you have a much better chance of realizing the ultimate goal of your invention, not only in perfecting it, but manufacturing it and marketing it to a growing consumer economy. So it's the context in which this innovation that's taking place that is the limiting, factor, not that, you know, Americans or Europeans are smarter than Russians. Let's step back now and take a look at what is actually going on in the United States and in Europe. There, during this period, non-specialist craftsmen, mechanics, and tinkerers, in almost every single instance, self-trained and self-supporting. They are the ones who develop the bulk of the devices and systems that will, in time, shape the contours of the 20th century. There is nowhere, no place is a better example of this than the good old U.S. of A., where between 1866 and 1896, tens of thousands of citizens, inventing at the very grassroots level, are going to double the number of patents issued by American inventors each and every year. The era's most productive inventors are going to be seen in the United States at this time. They're people like Hiram Maxim, Alexander Graham Bell, Nikola Tesla, William Stanley, Elmer Sperry, and of course, the Wright brothers. What's curious about all of these people is that except for Alexander Graham Bell, not a single one of these individuals had a college degree. Not a one of them had an advanced degree. Not one of them. No university degree, they hadn't attended college. Their success doesn't come from education. Their success doesn't come from their social origins. It doesn't come from state patronage. They succeed because they possess high levels of technical literacy, mechanical skills, and the determination to apply their knowledge and abilities to practical ends. That's why they succeed. They are free from organizational entanglements, and they have financial independence. Not saying that they're wealthy necessarily. They have financial independence because they either run or are able to develop successful businesses. So they're engaging not only in inventing and entrepreneurial activity, they're also, in each instance, businessmen. So they've brought together the invention and the commercial activity. That's what's going to create that synergy in this case. They also have ready access to capital, coming usually from the sale of their inventions or from investors. So decades before the rise of industrial research laboratories, several generations before the institutionalization of government-funded research and development, it's the independent inventor entrepreneur who is going to spearhead America's emergence as the world's most technologically advanced and industrially adept nation on Earth. The foundation of America's 20th century greatness is really built from an innovative standpoint, from a technological standpoint, from the activities of these individual inventor entrepreneurs. Now, there's one I haven't talked about. He really does serve as sort of the quintessential, the prototypical figure of the age of synergy in the United States. It's a fellow by the name of Thomas Alva Edison. His rise from humble beginnings as a homeschooled country bumpkin into world-renowned as one of history's most famous and prolific inventors and successful businessmen. Edison really epitomizes the dynamic interaction between innovation and industry, profit and progress that characterizes the West's age of synergy and its culture of improvement. He's known for all sorts of things. He's best known for major breakthroughs like the electric phonograph, the incandescent light bulb, but he builds his career making incremental improvements to existing technological systems. That's how he gets his start. Edison begins his career working, he begins as a very young man working on the railway. He's got about a sixth or seventh grade education. And he leaves as a young boy, and he goes off to work on the railway, and there he discovers this other technology that's developing alongside the development of railways, and that's the telegraph system. And he's got a mechanical bent to him, and he's got a sharp mind. He's very good working with things. And he begins making incremental improvements to telegraph sending and receiving machines. And in the course of doing so, he goes to work for Western Union. And he's able to make incremental improvements, and he makes these incremental improvements. What he's able to do then is to patent those. And as he patents the improvements to the machines, he's able then to market those patents, he licenses them out, and raises money. And in time, he's going to use the money that he's accruing from his sale of patents to construct his famous laboratory in Menlo Park, New Jersey. It emerges in 1876. This is the forerunner of the modern industrial research laboratory. Edison calls it his invention factory. What makes this so unique is that the Menlo Park building and the Menlo Park factory that emerges around it is the first institution that systematizes the process of innovation. It makes innovation itself a system. He's assisted by a team of about 20 model makers, craftsmen, and skilled workers. He has a physicist and a chemist on staff as well. And he promises to deliver a minor invention every 10 days and a big thing every 6 months or so. And at the height of his career, he does exactly that, averaging 40 patents a year, or one every 9 days. Think about that for a second. He's patenting a new device every week and a half. That's amazing. By the time that he passes away, he has 1,091 separate patentable devices to his credit. Two more come after he dies. The patents have been filed and then he passes away. So 1,093 different things that Edison invents and patents. It's an absolutely amazing record. Edison's incredible productivity in the pursuit of making things better underscored the importance of autonomy and personal initiative to technical research and development. But there's something else about Edison's example that's important. His experience testifies to a very important but oftentimes overlooked component of invention, and that is the freedom to fail. The freedom to fail. He fails over and over. He's a famous, one of Edison's famous quotes. He says, if I failed 10,000 times, I haven't failed. I've simply identified 10,000 ways something doesn't work. But he can make a mistake. He can go down an alley only to find out it's a dead end. Why? Because he has the security of a research lab, assistance, and money coming in to support himself. That's what I mean by the freedom to fail. And the freedom to fail is a vitally important but overlooked component of technological development and innovation. But none of this would have been possible, despite his brilliance, if he didn't have the security provided by adequate financial support. His success also depends upon, again, the synergistic interdisciplinary energy transforming Western society and culture. Edison has access to the latest research in the field. He's able to rapidly commercialize his patentable techniques. He's going to have an effective marketing strategy in time. And he's going to have the continuous integration of cutting-edge advances into basic research. These things make Edison possible. He is ideally situated within contexts that inspire, encourage, and reward innovation. The complex system of industrial innovation and production that he pioneers at Menlo Park, and then later he's going to recreate another laboratory on a grander scale in West Orange, New Jersey, this is quickly copied by other inventor entrepreneurs. And very quickly, people like George Westinghouse, Nikola Tesla, Elmer Sperry, Elihu Thompson, Edward Weston, they also establish research laboratories. And they're going to be modeled after the Menlo Park and the West Orange laboratories. So now you have not simply Edison working and collaborating with his physicists and chemists and the builders at his factory. You've got now the growing expanse of a knowledge economy that's been augmented by these new research laboratories. Here's the problem for the Russians. How do you replicate this in the Russian context? That proves to be very difficult. In the absence of the entrepreneurial commercial networks, private research laboratories don't exist. Mendeleev's laboratory exists for 10 years. It's not really a private one, it's a government-funded one. The government's going to exercise a considerable amount of control and constraint over Mendeleev's activities. This is why he throws up his hands and he says, enough, I need freedom. Without freedom, you can't have innovation, you can't have science. So what continues to be the rule in Russia is the state is going to fund or support innovation and research. It's going to fund or support innovation and research that it thinks is useful. Its efforts to promote greater innovation, despite glasnost, despite efforts to foment this, prove to be broadly inadequate. Russian subjects could, and in some cases did, excel in scientific fields. But they tend to have success in fields that do not require significant material investment. For example, mathematics and physics. You can be an outstanding theoretical mathematician. You can be an outstanding cutting-edge theoretical physicist. But if you're a theoretical physicist or a theoretical mathematician, you're dealing with abstract ideas and concepts. You're not building and making things. And the age of synergy is above all an element, an era of building and making things, and then commercializing them and selling them. One of the excellent examples in this regard is a fellow by the name of Konstantin Tsiolkovsky. You'll have to know his name. He's got dates by them. So I want you to know Tsiolkovsky. He's a largely self-taught mathematician and provincial secondary school teacher who authors a series of unpublished analytical papers in the early 1880s on a range of subjects, from the effects of gravity on the human body to the kinetic theory of gases. In 1883, he's going to present a paper to the Russian Physical Chemical Society. The paper is called On Free Space. And it is a monumentally important theoretical paper because it establishes his reputation as the very first Russian to theorize about the physical properties of objects operating in the vacuum of outer space. So he's really thinking abstractly. He's thinking about what does it mean to operate in a vacuum? Where will you have a vacuum? Will you escape the Earth's orbit? You've entered into the cosmos, that's a vacuum. How do things work in outer space? He undertakes research for close to a decade on air current resistance using a homemade wind tunnel. He gets a little bit of money from the Russian Technical Society to do this. And in the process of undertaking this research, he returns to contemplating and writing about the cosmos. In 1903, he pens a very famous essay called On the Exploration of the Cosmos by Means of a Reaction-Propelled Apparatus. And what this essay does is it formulates the basic mathematical equations that are necessary to describe how rockets would perform in a zero-gravity environment. He's a provincial school teacher in Kaluga, out in the middle of nowhere, and he's establishing the mathematical principles for describing how rockets would operate in outer space. How far ahead of his time is he? He's decades ahead. Now, there are Americans and Europeans who are going to begin undertaking rocketry experiments. Robert Goddard is the fellow who gets a lot of credit for this, of course. Talk about him in a history of science and technology class if you're exploring the United States or the West. But it's Tsiolkovsky, who later is going to be recognized as a fellow who was absolutely a theoretical pioneer. But here's the thing about Tsiolkovsky. Although he's credited by the Russians as the grandfather of rocketry, and not without cause, he does not invent a single thing. He'll work on dirigible design and things like that, but no, he's a theorist. He's the one who first comes up with the idea of a separate stage rockets, of spacesuits, what you would need to survive in a vacuum of outer space if you're a cosmonaut. But he produces, again, he inspires an entire generation of physicists and engineers, but he doesn't produce anything practical himself. And in that regard, he's sort of prototypical. His emphasis is going to be on theoretical mathematics and physics. Those are his strong suits, and it's not coincidental that when we get to the Soviet period, the 1930s, the 1940s, the 1950s, all the way up almost to the end of the Soviet Union, where Soviet scientists excelled, mathematics and physics. Areas of science that you could apply theory, you didn't have to have those concrete contexts that support innovation, development, and commercialization. Russian technicians and scientists who are interested in applied commercial technologies, that's not what Tsiolkovsky's interested in. He's a theoretical. Russian technicians and scientists interested in applied commercial technologies are largely left to their own devices. They face capital scarcity, inadequate institutional networks, and this means that even the most promising inventors typically enjoy only limited success. The enterprising, or the lucky, might turn to Western investors for support. But too often, even those who achieve significant advances are going to see their efforts fail, owing to the empire's inhospitable climate and context for innovation and marketing. And there are two people who I want to talk about today that exemplify this peculiar trait of Russian technological development, Russian technological culture. Edison is the great example in the West of the inventor entrepreneur. He invents the light bulb, right? No, he does not. He invents the first commercially successful incandescent light bulb. There are a lot of people working on electric lighting in the 1860s, the 1870s, even going back to the 1840s with arc lamps. And there are two Russians at about the same time working separately from Edison who are going to be working on the process of electric lighting. One of them is a fellow by the name of Alexander Ladigin. He is known in Russia as the Russian Edison. But the truth of the matter is he doesn't have much in common with Thomas Edison beyond the fact that they both have an interest in electric lighting. Ladigin is born to a provincial noble family of modest means. He attends a military academy in Tambov as a young boy, and he enters the army. He's going to leave the service after 2 years to go to work in an armaments factory. And he scrapes together his own funds from his job in order to apply himself and his inventive mind to building and creating things. He sets about trying to develop two devices. The first is an electric-powered helicopter. That's not very successful. The other one is an incandescent light bulb. Here, he's going to have more success. In 1872, he secures a Russian patent for his concept of the lighting device. 2 years later, in 1874, he receives the Russian Academy of Sciences highest award. It's the Lomonosov Prize. Remember Mikhail Lomonosov from way back at the beginning of our class, Russia's great Renaissance man of the 18th century. He has achieved in 1874, working on his own, Russia's highest scientific award. But he never achieves commercial success. Why? How is it that a man so inventive and so brilliant could fail in that regard? Now, the concept of the incandescent light bulb. An incandescent light bulb generates light by using an electrical current to superheat a filament encased in a bulb to the point of illumination. Many inventors are working on this problem already, and many have already tried to develop bulbs of their own at the time that Ladigin is developing his. In certain respects, however, he is ahead of his time, and he's ahead even of Edison. He decides to use a carbon filament enclosed in a glass bulb filled with nitrogen. The idea is you're trying to prolong the life of the filament. And you guys know about this. Incandescent light bulb. You don't want the thing to burn out after 2 days. It doesn't do you any good. That filament has to last a long time for that light bulb to have any practical significance, any practical commercial importance. So that's the problem that he's trying to tackle. His solution to the quandary of the incandescent light bulb is almost identical to the solution that Edison finally settles on. The difference is that Edison's Menlo Park laboratory was equipped with advanced instruments and precision tools. These facilitate the design process. The American wizard could call upon his platoon of expert craftsmen to custom build, test, and production equipment. And this is where, this is the other aspect where Edison ends up with his 1,093 patents. It's not just that he's developing light bulbs and phonographs. Along the way, in order to develop the light bulb or the phonograph, he's developing testing tools and procedures to help facilitate the final solutions to that invention. And those processes and techniques he can patent along the way. One of the things he patents along the way, in the discovery of or the invention of the light bulb, he patents some of the world's most powerful vacuum pumps. Why do you need the vacuum pump? You need the vacuum pump because the vacuum pump is going to suck the air out of the bulb and seal it off with the filament in it so that it's going to last longer, if that makes sense. The filament's going to burn longer in the vacuum inside the bulb. That's a patentable device. He's able to do this, he's got the idea, but he's also got guys working to help him. Does Ladegan have this? Nope, not so much. Ladegan is working with very little support. He has inadequate tools. He has poor quality materials coming from Russian factories that are producing domestic goods. And as a result, he's wrestling with a host of basic defects in his device. And critically, one of the things that Ladegan's light bulbs suffer from is they have very poor vacuum seals. But there's Ladegan's incandescent bulb, 1874. Denied access to military testing facilities. You would think the military might be interested in something like this. In fact, what the military is interested in at this point in time, are developing large searchlights that you could illuminate the skies at night, or you could illuminate military installations. So Ladegan is going to scrape together private funds to build and market his bulbs. He makes a series of improvements, but even his most advanced prototypes are going to burn out too quickly. They don't last long enough to be commercially viable. So he's struggling to make ends meet. He takes a job as a metal worker in St. Petersburg. He's got a little bit of financial backing. When his principal financial supporter dies in 1876, his entire enterprise comes to a halt. By the middle of the 1880s, 10 years after Ladegan has achieved that high scientific award of the Lomonosov Prize, within a decade of that, Russia is inundated with cheap commercial incandescent bulbs imported from the United States. Because Edison had the wherewithal at his disposal not simply to devise the invention and to perfect it, but to market it and commercialize it. So what happens to Ladegan? He works for about 10 more years in Russia, and then he relocates abroad. He goes to France, and then finally he goes to the United States. And while in the United States, he resumes inventing. And he creates a series of new incandescent bulbs that employ different metallic filaments. Among these is a bulb with a tungsten filament. He's able to patent that version in 1893 and will ultimately sell it, irony of ironies, to Edison's General Electric Company in 1906. General Electric engineers and technicians will build upon Ladegan's tungsten filament bulb. That is the bulb that becomes the world standard in the 20th century. It's tied to a Russian invention and a Russian inventor. It's not just Edison. Ladegan is not the only Russian at this time who's working in the area of electric illumination. Another one is a fellow by the name of Pavel Yablochkov. He's going to encounter similar problems trying to bring his electric lighting to Russia as well. He's also a former military officer and a future electric innovator. He's born to less than well-to-do provincial nobility. But he differs from Ladegan by dint of the fact that he is formally trained as an engineer. He's a graduate of the Nikolaev Military Engineering School and the Technical Galvanic School. At the time, the Technical Galvanic School was the only military institution devoted to electrical engineering in all of Russia. Electrical engineering is one of those new emerging fields of the age of synergy. He leaves the army in 1871, takes up an administrative position working on the railway. And he learns in Moscow, through the Moscow Polytechnical Museum, of Ladegan's work. He knows that Ladegan is working on an incandescent bulb. That sort of inspires him to make his own mark in the emerging field of electrotechnology. He sets up a small laboratory of his own in 1874, the year that Ladegan gets the Lomonosov Prize, quits his position with the railroad, and it turns his attention full-time to experiment and design. Now, there's a difference. Where Ladegan is working on an incandescent light bulb, Yablochko is working on something else. He's working on what we call an arc lamp. An arc lamp. A device that achieves illumination by passing a current between two carbon electrodes. Now, the basic concept is not new. In fact, it's rather old. The idea had been known to European scientists since the late 18th century. Arc lights, they're harsh, they're bright, they produce a lot of heat, and that makes them generally unsuitable for interior lighting. You can use them for outdoor lighting, for lighting large stadiums. You could use them for lighting large factories. And in fact, an arc lamp is going to be used as early as 1849 by the Paris Opera. They use one to create artificial sunrises and sunsets in one of its productions. So you've got an arc lamp, but what you need now is you need an entire system built around it to make the system commercially viable. And that's what inventors are struggling to do. Find some way of making this commercially viable. You have the invention, you have an arc lamp, but one arc lamp's not going to make you rich. One arc lamp is not going to change the world. The problems you encounter: inadequate electrical supply, and the need to constantly readjust the opposing electrodes, because you want to keep them even. If they don't burn evenly, you're going to have inadequate and uneven lighting. You think about how difficult it is to read or operate in a room where the lights are flickering or dimming and brightening from time to time. That's the technical challenge you're trying to overcome. Within a year or so of establishing his factory in Russia, Yablochko hits upon the ingenious design that's going to make him famous. His solution involves placing the electrodes side by side. Typically what folks had done, and this is his arc lamp, rather than placing the electrodes side by side, they were placed point to point so that you've got that electrical current going between them. He places them side by side, and in between them, he puts a piece of kaolin china. What that does is it helps ensure that the electrical current is going to insulate the two tips of the elements, prolonging their life and producing a constant lighting source. So you're controlling the flow of electricity using that little piece of kaolin china. He struggles for close to 2 years to obtain the funding and materials in Moscow to move this concept into production. Again, you've got the invention, but having the invention isn't enough. You've demonstrated that it works. You've got to have money now to build a factory to produce these things in quantity. Then you can turn around and market it to people who want to buy it. That's the problem that Yablochko has. Where's the market in Russia? Where's the capital going to come from? He works, struggles for 2 years to develop it in Moscow, finally throws up his hands and leaves Moscow for Paris, which at the time was a center for electrical engineering research and development. In 1876, he gets a French patent for his design, and soon thereafter, deep-pocketed Western investors pony up the money he needs to purchase the equipment to create a commercialized system. In 1878, at the Paris Exposition, 64 of Yablochko's lamps, his arc lamps, are going to illuminate an area of the city's center. This is the first outdoor electric lighting in world history, the first demonstration of a working system. And it's undertaken in downtown Paris, not in Moscow or St. Petersburg. It's an absolutely stunning display. It predates by 4 years Edison's famous Wall Street demonstration of his incandescent lighting system. In the wake of the Paris Exposition, orders pour in to Yablochko's emerging company. He benefits from Western Europe's stronger industrial base and better financing, better market demand, and business grows very, very rapidly. By the middle of the 1880s, so-called Yablochkov candles are the most popular arc lamps in Europe. They illuminate streets, public gardens, large factories in Paris and London, and in other major cities. Here's a drawing from about the 1880s, late 1880s, early 1890s. Those are Yablochkov candles, the incandescent light bulbs that are illuminating this very large interior space. It's only in the aftermath of the Russian inventor's foreign success that the Russian state and military finally pay attention to what the inventor's been doing. Now all of a sudden, the Russian military and the Russian state are eager to make use of this lighting system. And so they convince Yablochkov to return to Russia to set up a factory in St. Petersburg. The homecoming is not exactly what anyone expected. Yablochkov's factory in Russia is underwritten by state subsidies and contracts, but his business struggles to make money. His principal purchaser is the state itself. Higher production costs and material costs in Russia, the need to employ skilled personnel to operate and maintain the lamps, make even the most basic system prohibitively expensive in the Russian context. By 1881, of the 750 arc lamps in the entire Russian Empire, 2/3 of them were installed in military installations or in factories related to military industrial production. And the contexts are important. Yablochkov faces restricted markets, scant profits. After 6 years of trying, he closes up shop and returns to Paris. And it is there he's going to resume research and development. He secures an additional 34 patents before he dies in 1894. An ingenious Russian inventor who is constrained by the context in which he's trying to operate in the Russian Empire. That's the problem. It's not their native inventiveness. Commercial, cultural, political, economic constraints. The dilemmas experienced by Yablochkov and Ladygin are simply emblematic of the hurdles that Russians faced attempting to match Western technological ingenuity in the two generations prior to World War I. The growing complexity and immense scale of Western technological and scientific achievements made Russia's innovation challenge exponentially more difficult. Incredible capital outlays are going to be required to establish new electrical generation and distribution networks, to construct metropolitan and interurban railways, to set up telegraph and telephone exchanges, to modernize existing coal, petroleum, and metallurgical enterprises. But building these systems is only one aspect of the technological modernization that's underway during the Age of Synergy. You need, in order for this technological system to function, like we see here with New York, right, this is New York in the 1880s and 1890s. This is, one of the famous bridges overlooking New York. We're looking here at the height here of Western and American ingenuity. You need more than simply inventors. You need, as well, proficient managers, skilled technicians, literate workers to maintain these systems once they're in operation. And after the systems are in operation, the rapid improvements occasioned by increasingly global market competition required reserves of intellectual capital and entrepreneurial drive that Tsarist Russia simply did not possess. This is the fundamental dilemma facing the autocratic state at the turn of the 20th century. How do you cultivate subjects' knowledge and independence of thought? How do you cultivate the development of their technical and innovative skill, which you must have as prerequisites to entrepreneurial inventiveness? How do you cultivate all of these traits that you have in abundance in Western Europe without upsetting the social and political hierarchies that sustain absolutism? How do you generate innovative thought? How do you generate free enterprise without infringing upon autocratic prerogative, without taking power away from the state? Now, the educational reforms that were introduced in the wake of emancipation had done much to advance the empire's knowledge economy. And the number of students between 1865 and 1880, the number of students attending university in Russia nearly doubled in that 15-year period. It's a direct product of the Great Reforms. that sounds fantastic. Except when you step back to realize the number of university students, although it nearly doubles in 15 years, is still very, very tiny relative to the overall population. Between 1865 and 1880, you go from about 4,125 students to just over 8,000. In an empire of 90 million? Following a decade of political retrenchment in the 1880s, the university population is going to double again in 1899 to reach 16,000. Then on the eve of the World War I, it explodes to almost 70,000. There's a real concerted effort here by the state to expand university education. And beyond that, to create specialized technical institutes run by state ministries. They are also going to see comparable enrollment increases. They increase from 3,750 students in 1859 to 58,000 in 1914. And at the same time that the state and the military are creating these technical institutes and feeding the universities, you also have the vocational programs that are run by the Russian Technical Society, and I mentioned those in my last lecture. Primary education is going to be expanded as well, thanks in no small part here to the local zemstvas. That's going to be their major contribution. In 1880, across the entire Russian Empire, you know how big it is, in 1880, there were only 23,000 primary schools. By 1914, that number had risen to over 108,000. So you're seeing rapid, fantastic growth. All of this is very, very good, but these educational establishments suffer from the same things that Russian invention suffers from, namely a lack of adequate resources. One of the reasons that the state even allows the Russian Technical Society and the zemstvas to enter into what we might call the education business is because the state doesn't have the money to do it itself. It's going to leave it to the Russian Technical Society. It's going to leave it to the zemstvas to give them an opportunity to tax a little bit, or in the zemstva case, gives them responsibility for it. But funding for education at all levels remains very, very poor. And that is going to be a constant drag on the development of the empire's technological and scientific sectors. It's also going to do something else. You're sending growing numbers of young men, and in time, young women. By the 1880s and 1890s, women are entering into these, not only the universities, but the technical schools as well. You're sending them increasing numbers into these educational establishments that are poorly funded in most instances, except for the most elite universities, like Moscow State University or St. Petersburg University. They're going to universities where the conditions in which they're studying are not optimal, to say the least. Students are facing, as students today know, you face difficult economic circumstances. You're not rolling in dough, you're eating ramen or whatever, you're scraping to get by, trying not to take out too many loans. Folks, it's nothing new. The economic plight of university students has been a near universal constant in the history of education. It's particularly true for students enrolled in Russian enterprises, Russian educational establishments. Upwards of 80% of all students in the Russian Empire relied on financial assistance in the form of scholarships, tuition waivers, discretionary grants, and charity. Among some of the more important voluntary associations that emerge in the wake of the Great Reform are voluntary associations that are designed to help out students, to provide stipends and funds and food and aid to students attending university or technical, polytechnical institutes. Regardless of these avenues of support, the amount that was available was met only the most basic needs of students. A majority of students receive some form of assistance from family members, but that too is also rarely enough, especially for students who are attending school in Moscow or St. Petersburg, where you have very high costs of living. You know, if you have a parent who can send you $100 or $200 a month to defray your educational expenses, the $100 or $200 a month will go a lot longer, will go a lot farther, say, in Omaha, Nebraska, than they will in New York or Chicago. We just have higher costs of living. So if you're in the urban metropolis, higher costs of living means your problem is your economic plight is exacerbated. One 1909 survey indicated that the average student in Moscow lived on 25 rubles a month. Now, how much was that? That was enough for one full meal a day, supplemented by tea and bread in the evening. That's it. I said that the student body is rapidly growing. It does. And the rapid growth of the student body easily outpaces the growth of the faculty available to teach them. This is a further complicating matter. As late as 1912, the ratio of Russian students to teachers was between 2 and 5 times higher than comparable German schools. Many instructors sympathize with the students' plight, sympathize with the students' dire financial straits. That's particularly true of the young instructors, who may graduate university and then immediately be asked for an appointment, immediately given an appointment because there are so few teachers. Hey, you've got a degree, you've graduated, you've shown some aptitude, come back and teach. And what they face, like the students, inadequate supervision, overcrowding, student poverty, all of this is going to compromise the quality of education, but it does something else. It's going to help foment unrest and disciplinary problems. Students will form study circles, mutual aid societies, and cooperative dormitories to try and ease their burdens. They develop what the Russians refer to as studentchestvo, the sense of belonging as students. You might call it, I suppose, sort of a student common consciousness, the common cause, the common plight of university students everywhere. You identify with one another, that's studentchestvo. Widespread sentiment that university students share a special collective identity that sets them apart from existing social categories. Now, student organizations could run afoul of state agents that routinely monitor universities and student activities. Independent, unsanctioned student groups were routinely quashed by authorities. Offending students could lose their stipends, they could be confined in the university jail, they could be expelled. Invariably, of course, these repressive measures only prove to be counterproductive. The students are upset about their economic plight, the state steps in to impose its will to quash the student unrest. That only served then to intensify student dissatisfaction and in the process turn their economic grievances into political ones. The student body in Russia is going to become increasingly radicalized in the 1880s and the 1890s. Higher education is going to emerge as one of the, higher educational institutes are going to emerge as seedbeds of opposition to the autocratic state. They become one of the real sources for revolutionary unrest. Bureaucratic disagreements over how best to respond to growing student activism are going to be hampered by the development of a unified governmental approach. There just isn't one. And all this is going to change in the aftermath in 1881 of the assassination of Alexander II. With the autocratic system now under direct attack by revolutionary forces, the new Tsar, Alexander III, is going to reverse nearly all of his father's liberalizing methods. And that's one of the ironies of Alexander II. He emancipates the serfs, he initiates the Great Reform, he expands the university, only to find that what he has done in attempting to improve and modernize the country is to sow the seeds of further radical discontent. And what results is a crackdown on the revolutionary movement and a crackdown on student dissent. The new Tsar, Alexander III, reasserts monarchical authority. City councils are going to see their power curtailed. Zemstvo assemblies will see their powers curtailed. Changes are going to take place as well within the educational establishment under the leadership of a fellow by the name of Ivan Delianov, who is appointed Minister of Education and is given the task of transforming the empire's universities from, quote, hotbeds of political agitation to hotbeds of science. He's going to centralize control of the daily operations of students, daily operations of universities. He's something else that he wants to do, and that is to divert individuals from quote-unquote less desirable backgrounds. He wants to divert them away from universities and into less prestigious technical and vocational schools. A new university statute passed in 1884 overturns basically all of the liberalizing measures introduced under Alexander II. Glasnost in institutions of higher education comes to an end. Universities are now going to be brought under the direct control of the Ministry of Education. Academic autonomy is eliminated. Faculty governance disappears. State functionaries are going to take over the appointment, promotion, and dismissal of professors. After 1885, students are going to be required to wear distinctive uniforms so that authorities can identify them in the city when they're out on the street. And if you look here at this picture from St. Petersburg University around 1900, what you'll see is they're all wearing what looked to be military uniforms. Can you guys imagine that? If you had to wear uniforms to come to class? So that when you're outside of class and you're screwing around and causing problems, I can identify you and I can report you to the police. Because if I don't do that, I'm going to lose my job as a faculty member. I have to police your activities by reporting on you. The ministry also issues detailed regulations governing minute aspects of student life. If you're going to apply to get into university, you have to submit a report on your social origins and your past activities. Police surveillance is going to be greatly expanded. Students are denied the right to form any kind of independent association or public assembly without the express permission of the authorities. We've gone back now to that repressive atmosphere of Nicholas I, orthodoxy, autocracy, and nationality, when again, constrained by the state and constrained by regulations, where did those university students gather? They gathered in the Krujok, in that secretive discussion circle. These will reemerge in force in the 1880s and the 1890s, only now they're not advocating romanticism and they're not listening to Beninsky. What they're doing is they're bringing in the more radical ideas, socialism, in time anarchism, revolutionary ferment aimed at toppling the autocracy. The new regulations do two things. Both of them are counterproductive to Russian development. They are going to, in the long run, inspire even greater dissatisfaction among the students and thus heighten student discontent. And the other thing they do, of course, is they constrain Russia's emerging knowledge economy. Particularly damaging was the fact that the government bureaucrats now assumed the right to determine all aspects of the university curriculum. Faculty are required to submit their written lectures in advance to the Ministry of Education. God, I wouldn't teach a single course. I couldn't get them done in time, right? And it's the Ministry of Education now that's going to coordinate the content of courses and exams. Leading academicians, leaders in their fields, are left with little freedom to emphasize their own theoretical views or research experience. The impact of this is going to be devastating for about a decade. Some professors respond to the government crackdown by simply abandoning teaching and pursuing non-academic careers. Others are going to leave the country altogether. The number of university students declines in the 1880s as tuition increases, state stipends are reduced, again to control student unrest, and applicants are required to formally attest to the fact they do not belong to disapproved organizations. This is going to keep many talented individuals from actually pursuing further education. So all of this is an attempt on that. This is the quandary here of Russian development from the standpoint of the autocratic state. You need educated citizens or educated subjects. You need folks with technical knowledge. You send them to university, you send them here to the polytechnics, but they're not behaving. They're doing things, they're organizing, they're causing problems. You're going to crack down on them, but if you crack down on them, then where do you get the technicians? You have a quandary. You guys take a break, stretch your legs, come back, and I'll give you an example of one of these fellows. We'll talk a little bit more about this. Work our way here toward the emergence in time of the Russian revolutionary movement. Probably going to get to that on the other side of the break.